There is a word from the Lord today, and it's the gospel lectionary lesson for today. And I call your attention to the gospel of Jesus Christ as recorded by John, chapter 1, verses 29 through 42. Out of reverence for the reading of the gospel lesson, I'm going to ask you as you're able to stand. And you will be tested on the sermon today. The next day, he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'About me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother, Simon, and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated, anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated, Peter. My sisters and brothers, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. And your response is, you may be seated. Let us pray. In the stillness of these moments now, God, be so kind as to speak to me, even me, so that some way, somehow, I in return might speak to my sisters and brothers with power, authority, and with simplicity, to the end that each one of us, in hearing from you, might receive, their hearts might be touched and changed and made better. So hide me somewhere behind the cross of the Christ, so that I might clearly see him, and give me sufficient strength to lift him high through the preached word, so that others might see him and come to accept him as Lord and Savior. Let the words, therefore, of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The subject today is simply entitled The Revelation. The revelation. We're living in a significant part of history. I don't know if it has dawned upon us that today is the birthday. It is the anniversary of the remembrance of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., one who lived amongst us and touch our lives, and who became a leader of the civil rights movement. He didn't ask for it. He had prepared himself well, happened to be a graduate of Morehouse College, matriculated at Crozier Theological Seminary, earned a PhD degree, did not come back to Atlanta, but went to Alabama, Montgomery, Alabama, where he was perceived as a successful pastor of the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. And there happened to be a woman, you know the story, Rosa Parks by name, seamstress by profession, got on a segregated bus, and some of you will remember segregation in the transit authorities in our land, particularly those of us who lived and grew up in the South. Atlanta was no exception, that we had segregated the bus system here in Atlanta, where whites sat in the front of the bus and blacks sat in the back of the bus. And if there were no more room in the front of the bus and there was room in the back of the bus, that blacks had to get up from their seats, give up their seats, and move to the back of the bus. Mrs. Rosa Parks was tired, and she had worked all day long, and she was directed to move to the back. And I suppose some would say she had an attitude, and she refused to move to the back of the bus and ended up being arrested. And out of that arrest, there emerged the Montgomery bus boycott. And the civil rights movement was launched in a significant way. And we are reminded of that revelation even today. And Dr. King was new and young pastor in Montgomery, and his colleagues called upon him to lead the movement. He did not volunteer. But he was chosen by acclamation to be the leader, and he led us exceptionally well. In fact, his leadership was felt all over the country and even beyond. And tomorrow is the observance of the national holiday, the King holiday. That speaks in significance to us as a people, that an African American has the observance of a national holiday. And some of that history, I'm reminded that this occurred in 1986. And I'm reminded how upset I became because there was only one church in Atlanta in January 1986 had an observance. And that was Ebenezer Baptist Church. And my mama and stepdad were members of Ebenezer, and I was upset because people who supported Ebenezer week in and week out could not get into the church because of the dignitaries who filled every pew. And I said at that time, we won't have to worry. I said that Cascade next year will have the observance of King Holiday. I did not know, Dorothy, at that time, your husband would move from Ben Hill and go on the cabinet. And I did not know that I would be moved from Cascade as senior pastor to the Ben Hill Church. And so whereas Cascade did not have the observance in January 1987, Ben Hill did. And McKinley Young, who was the pastor then, of the Big Bethel African Methodist Episcopal Church, I invited to be the speaker. And I remember McKinley said to me that, Walter, we got more folk in Ben Hill than they got in Ebenezer because the people turned out in mass, were happy that they had a place they could participate in the national observance. It's my hope that we will find something meaningful to do tomorrow. That we won't simply celebrate the fact that we don't have to go to work or don't have to go to school. That Ben Hill is still having observance at 10 o'clock in the morning. That's where I'm going to observe it. Or you can find something that you can do to help somebody else. And then when I think of what Dr. King gave, he gave his life at the age of 39. He was a young man, younger than most of us in this room right now. He was on the balcony at the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee, where he went in support of garbage collectors. If you would allow me just a moment to say nasty, stinking garbage collectors that nobody wanted to be bothered with, Dr. King, even though he didn't feel well, was mandated to go and to speak to the people, and the next morning he was gunned down, 39 years of age. And that leads me now to Jesus the Christ, who was revolutionary in his own right. Had not done anyone any wrong, but had gone about his life doing good, trying to help everybody in need, lifting fallen humanity. In fact, who came because we were in trouble? Who came into the world because we were headed for eternal death and destruction? I'm really trying to say we were on our way to hell and we really didn't know it. And because of God's magnificent love for us, sent his only begotten Son into the world to be a source of salvation for us. And I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm excited about it today because I didn't ask for Jesus to come. I didn't ask for any help. I really didn't know I needed any help, but God knew I needed help. And God knew you needed help too, even though you nor I had been born then, but God knew what was in the pipeline and that we would be messed up in our sin, just like the people in the first century were. And so Jesus Christ came into the world for us, for me, and for you. And there's something significant about it. And even though he went about doing good, even though he had not mistreated anybody, even though he gave the best that he had in support of the people, in fact, his life was cut short at the age of 33. Could it not mean when you're really giving all that you have, that life is temporary? Watch it now. Life is temporary for all of us. None of us have come here to stay. All of us one day, sooner or later, are going to check out. And I don't care who your physician happens to be. I don't even care how many physicians you have. You're going to check out from here. You're going to leave here. And everything you accumulated, you're going to leave for somebody else to enjoy or mess over. So then the issue is that inasmuch as Jesus came and died for us, in other words, this didn't simply die for naught, but died so that we might have a right to life and right to eternal life. I'm excited about that. My wife taught a class over at Clark Atlanta University, and one student said, I studied these major religions of the world, and I looked at Buddha. Buddha died, and he's still dead. But when I looked at Jesus, Jesus died, and the third day morning he got up, and he still lives today. And that's the reason even today we can sing, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I'm happy to be a Christian because there's something special about us who are followers of Jesus Christ. And the text lifts that up, that we have to have a revelation of Jesus Christ. And if we fail to have a revelation of Jesus Christ, we have missed the significance of it. In other words, I read from the book of Revelation how John, now in this final book of the Bible, talks about being on the island of Patmos, being there because of the stance that he had taken in his faith. And he said, you know, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And I had to chew, Rod, I had to chew on that. He didn't say I was in the Spirit on the Sabbath day, but rather I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Don't you know we aren't Seventh-day Adventists? We aren't even Jews because they worship on the Sabbath day. But something special happened in our lives early on Easter Sunday morning when he got up
and declared that all power was in his hand. That's where we stand, and that's the reason we don't worship God on the Sabbath. We worship on the Lord's Day. And John said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day, on Sunday, the first day of the week. And we ought to start out at least on the first day of the week worshiping the Lord. We ought to, yeah, praise him. And so then, here in this gospel account, in this first chapter, in this lectionary text for today, that John the Baptist is giving us some dynamic leadership. I have 4 points today. Normally I'm a 3-point preacher, but I tried the best I could and cut it down to 4. I needed to cut it down, and so I did. And I'm going to be now as brief as possible, Marge. Thank you. Because I'll hear about it when I get home. There are 4 words I needed to share for your theological and intellectual discourse. The first word I share for you is the declaration. You can see it. Marty's going to put it up in the declaration in verses 29, 30, and 31. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared. Thank you. Okay, now you don't have to talk to me now. That's the reason it's up here. Those you got your Bibles, turn to it. And the next day, he saw Jesus, meaning John the Baptist, coming toward him, and that's where I got declaration from. I just want you to know where it comes from. He declared. He made a declaration. He had to respond when he saw Jesus coming toward him. In other words, what happens to you when you see Jesus passing by your house? In fact, Zacchaeus saw him coming, and Zacchaeus ran on up ahead of Jesus and climbed up in a sycamore tree. He was short of stature. He wanted to make sure he saw Jesus as Jesus was passing by. And the text says, and Jesus looked up into that tree and called him by his name. What are you going to do when Jesus sees you and calls you by your name and says, come on down, I'm going to your house today? And when he tells you he's going to your house, will he be welcome? So then the declaration is here. He says, John the Baptist, here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. My sin, your sin, Donald Trump's sin. He doesn't know he's a sinner, but he takes it away. This is, I don't know if that makes sense to anybody. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me. Because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. So then, there has to be a declaration. When Jesus becomes real in your life, stop keeping it to yourself. When you come into salvation, when you know that your sin has been forgiven, you ought to be able to tell somebody. Yes. Because when you tell somebody, you become a blessing for somebody else. Don't be selfish with your blessing. Share your blessing with somebody else. Then the somebody else you share with will be blessed. And the world's going to be better. I don't know how many of you watch football. But Marty, raise your hand, Marty. Raise your hand. Okay, there he is. All righty. Marty is as happy as he can be. Because in the playoff, the Falcons are not one and out. they're going to play another game. Then somebody, I've been going to South Carolina every month, and some of my clergy colleagues in South Carolina asked me about the Falcons, and I said the Falcons are better now, in my estimation, than they've ever been, because they really have team spirit. I haven't always seen that. It's a team. It's a team, and in my estimation, they can go all the way. Now, but you have to tell somebody. You know, folk will jump on you when you ain't doing nothing. Folk will talk about you when you're making mistakes in your life. You see, people will low-rate you when you make a blunder in your life. Don't get locked up and everybody going to talk about it. The phones are going to ring. Oh, God. But somebody ought to say something when you're doing good. Somebody ought to say something when you're excelling. Margie and I had dinner last evening with our granddaughter from New Orleans, and that she was in national competition, her team, and they didn't win this year. Poor thing, the spirit was crushed. But I had to say, Lydia, y'all have won it 5 years in a row. Yeah, you don't want it 5 years in a row. Let somebody else win it. I said the likelihood it'll be 100 years before somebody else will win it 5 years in a row. But we want to win. We want to win consistently. But celebrate somebody else's winning. Celebrate the victory. So then, the first word is what now? Declaration. And the second word is the testimony. We can pick that up in verse 32, 33, and 34. But look at verse 32, where you see the testimony. It is very significant indeed. Because the text says in 32, and John... Y'all get it? I mean, I'm not brilliant, y'all. I just read. And John what? Testify. Some of you all are old enough, remember, when the saints in the life of the church, particularly on watch night, had what? Yeah. Testified. Over in Summer Hill, they did what? They testified. They talked about how good God's been to them. That God's brought me from a mighty long ways. I mean, you follow what I'm saying? And my grandpa would pray, thank you, dear Jesus, you brought me from a mighty long ways all the way from Alabama down here to Georgia. Thank you, dear Jesus. He didn't say dear. It was dear Jesus. And so we had a testimony. Wasn't supposed to make it. But we've made it thus far by the grace of God. And so here in the text that there was a testimony, and we've got to have a testimony as well. And Sarah Walker is here today. You used to lead a song that says, I got a what? I got a testimony. And when you were singing that song, I mean, it got all over you. I mean, it grabbed you, didn't it? Because you had a testimony. And guess what? You still got a testimony. I mean, you weren't supposed to be here today, but you got a what? I'm here anyhow, by the grace of God. I mean, nobody rolled you in a wheelchair, but you got a what? I've got a testimony. And somebody else in here got a testimony. Because the enemy has been willing bad things to happen in your life, but you've got a testimony that you made it by God's grace. Yeah. David said, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And you got a testimony today that you covered in front and you are covered in the rear. Testimony. Let me hurry on. I'm about through. Third word. The first word is what now?
Testimony.
Second word is what?
Testimony.
And now the third word is the exclamation. It's in the book. It's right here in the book. Huh. Look down to verse 35. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he what?
Exclaimed.
It's in the book, isn't it? All right, now watch this. Watch this. Look, here is the Lamb of God. Now can I read it again? Look, here is the Lamb of God. You smart students, what kind of, is that a period after that word? What is it? It's a. In other words, the church at sometimes, when us get together, something ought to happen up in here that you can get excited about. Look, here is the Lamb of God. And if you can't get a shout off of that, then I don't know what's going to make you shout. And so there's something significant about it, that the Lamb of God is with us. And we can be excited about it, excited about it. You know, thousands of people were in that stadium yesterday, and they were just excited as they could be. But we ought not to have to go to the dome to get excited. I'm not against that. I embrace that. But in every church established in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, there ought to be some excitement going on up in here right now. All righty? So, exclamation. And I'm just begging you, get excited about your journey with the Master. And hurriedly now, I want to go to the fourth word that says something, very, very important. Instruction. Verse 37. There are some classroom teachers and former classroom teachers in here. Instruction is pivotal. We need teachers to help us learn. And so in verses 37 through 39, we find these words. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" They said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Jesus saw them following him and said, "What are you looking for?" You're supposed to feel it when somebody is watching you. And you're certainly supposed to feel it when somebody is following you. And Jesus was very sensitive. He was sensitive that he was being followed. And raised the question, "What are you looking for?" And they responded, "We want to know, where are you staying?" And what was his response? Instructional.
Come and see.
Come and see. When I was a young pastor serving in Chicago, Illinois, I didn't understand it. On Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, Old South Park, there was a Baptist church. And the name of it was Come and See Baptist Church. I never got it. Come and See Baptist Church. I never went there, but I'm going back the last of April to Chicago when the ice melts. And I want to go back home and see Baptist Church. And I want to see if it's still there. But isn't it significant? Jesus said,
if you want to know
where I'm going, do what?
Come
and see. I don't have to tell you. Come and
see.
There was a church out in Decatur. It was a very large church, Rehoboth Baptist Church. And the members of that church had bumper sticker that read, "Follow me to Rehoboth." Mm-hmm. Now that's a bad sign to put on your bumper if you aren't going
to Rehoboth.
I'm trying to say if you're going to some place that does not represent Rehoboth, you know, if you go to those kinds of places, take that sign off. But I'd like to say it, follow me to Rehoboth. I really like it. But Jesus is saying, if you want to know where I'm staying, come and see. When we come into the Lord's house, that we ought to know this is the Lord's house. Let me see if I can't say it another way. In other words, this congregation carries the name United Methodist, but it's really the Lord's church. And Jesus said, upon this rock, I will build what? My church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Watch this now. And this may be my last time coming here. I don't know, but and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I tried to understand what Jesus was saying. Not that hell wouldn't come. Stop crying because things are tough in your life and you feel like you're going through hell. I don't care if you're going through hell. Just underscore the word through. It's all right, because I've come to tell you today is hell won't always last. You're going to get through it. You're going to rise above it. You're going to make it in spite of, because God is all powerful. I'm not here to tell you Satan ain't strong. Mine is strong, but not as strong as God. And you've got to know who you're serving. Whose side are you on? Even David said, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because what? Thou art with me. I don't care how big that valley is. Once you go halfway and take the next step, you're on your way out of it. Amen. You're on your way out of it. You're on your way out of it. You're on your way out of it. And so the issue is, we come here and we've got a wonderful teaching pastor at Cliftondale. He's wonderful. In fact, I talk about him and what I say about him, he's one of the three best preachers we got in North Georgia. We are fortunate to have Pastor K, the other K, as pastor here, because he's brilliant, brilliant guy. And he's an excellent teacher. So we come here for the instruction so that our lives will be transformed, made better, and we go out of here and we can stand even when folk don't like you. And watch this. As wonderful as you are, everybody does not like you. And I want you to stop crying because folk don't like you. You ought to get your shout on anyway. Oh, hallelujah. Because the Bible says, woe unto him whom everyone speaketh well of. I don't care if you don't like me. You better love me because I'm God's child. All right, I'm going to say this and I'm through. The revelation ends up in conclusion with, when you come into an encounter with Jesus Christ, you have a moral obligation to go and tell somebody. Get them. and bring them to the Christ that you've met with the encounter. They brought others. They brought others. And that has to be our assignment. Amen. Amen. Do you receive that? All right, okay.